Well, good morning, church. How are you guys doing? Good. Who had a good Christmas holiday? Did you guys get what you wanted? Get toys and Hot Wheels and stuffed animals? Love it. So, as you guys have probably heard, this morning we are going to speak about priorities. So, for those of you who don't know me, my name is Pastor Owen. I am the high school pastor here at CCC. And this sermon is just something that God really laid on my heart. He laid it on my heart a couple weeks ago at youth. And me and Pastor Steve kind of talked. And he kind of wanted me to share it with you guys because this is something that we all need to hear. This is something that we all need to apply to our lives. And especially going into the New Year's, what's something we do when the New Year comes up? We set New Year's resolutions, go to the gym for a week and eat healthy for 2 weeks. And this is something that hopefully our New Year's resolution will carry out throughout the entire year. So on New Year's, what are some things that we do as well? We go and we hang out with friends, we hang out with family, we watch the ball drop, we kiss someone, right? Some of us. But anyway, these are some awesome traditions. Sorry, I'm a walker. These are some traditions that we like to carry out. But another tradition that I think we should do is we should reprioritize. When the New Year starts up, we reprioritize what's important in our life. So, kind of, we just had Thanksgiving, we just had Christmas, now we got New Year's coming up. What's something that we also do? We get together with family, we have traditions, we have celebrations for Thanksgiving, we sit down, we eat till we fall asleep. For Christmas, we eat till we fall asleep and hang out with family and maybe open up some presents. Someone dresses up as Santa Claus and we watch The Grinch and we watch Elf. But something that nonetheless happens is we hang out with friends and family. Now let me ask you, during these times, do you prioritize that? Do you prioritize family? When you have that weird uncle that comes to the Thanksgiving who's always weird and you're always like, I don't really want to talk to you, or you have that relative that is always trying to nag in your ear, tugs on your cheek, kisses your cheek, you're like, back off, bro, I'm 23 years old, you don't got to tug on my cheek anymore, I'm not a baby. But we all have that, right? And so my question to you is, do you prioritize family? Yes, it may feel weird when you're 23 and your grandparents tugging on your cheek, but it's times like that you prioritize family. When you have that conversation, when you're sitting down and you're talking about something you don't even care about, are you really engaged? Are you prioritizing that time with your family? What if I told you that the second most important commandment in the Bible, the second most important commandment that Jesus teaches the disciples is to love others? In Matthew 22, verses 36 through 40, it says, the disciples are talking to Jesus. They say, Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus replied, Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. Please bow your heads and pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, God, I want to thank you for this year, God. I want to thank you for all the things that you've done in the church, through your church, God. I know that a lot of us have had some ups and downs, God, but I just thank you for helping us be persistent, for pushing through, for getting us through the year, God. I pray that today that you would open up hearts, God, you would open up minds, that your church would be expecting you to move, God, that this isn't just another Sunday, this isn't just another day where we come, we sit in the chairs, we listen to a quick message, and we leave and go on our way, God. But I pray that we would leave today changed, we would leave today hungry, we would leave today with new priorities. In your heavenly name, amen. So as we can see in this small passage, Jesus makes it very clear. He doesn't beat around the bush. He said, these are the two most important commandments. Love your God and love others. He says in verse 40, all the law and prophets hang on these two commandments. So today we're going to be discussing three priorities that we need to prioritize in our life. The first one being prioritize God. This means that when times are great, give thanks to God. When times are bad, lean on God. And when it's all in between, trust in God. God will always be there. In your downtime, spend time with God. In your busy time, spend time with God. Talking to God and hanging out with God might be the single easiest thing you could do. Because thanks to Jesus, we have this amazing being called the Holy Spirit that's with us everywhere that we go. So right now, Jesus is sitting next to you. When you hop in your car, when you walk through the frigid cold, Jesus is walking next to you. When you're at home sitting on your couch watching a movie, all bundled up in a warm blanket, Jesus is right there next to you. He is with you always. So there's literally no excuse you can have to not spend time in a talk with God. Now, a small little thing that I started doing is I love to work out. Some of you may not, but I love to work out, and I always try to figure out a time to squeeze God into my day. And so something I started doing when I was in college is whenever I'd be making up my pre-workout, I'd say a quick prayer. And now that's become a habit to me, so now I can't even mix up pre-workout without saying a prayer. It's just weird to me. If I try to do it without, I'm like, oh, gotta pray. But that's just something that in your day-to-day lives, make time for God. I try to make an excuse, oh, well, I'm going to be working out. That's going to be weird. I'm going to be jamming out to elevation. It's going to be weird. I can't pray to God. I'm pumping iron. But God's like, who gave you that ability? I'm like, okay, you're right, God. I'll pray with you. In Psalms 28, verse 7, it says, the Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and he helps me. My heart leaps for joy, and with my song, I praise him. Now, quickly moving to Psalms chapter 9, verses 10, it says, those who know your name trust in you, for you, Lord, have never forsaken those who seek you. In Philippians chapter 4, verses 13, it says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. These are just a few examples in the Bible of what God does for us. In the first passage, it says, the Lord is my strength and my shield. When times are tough, when you lose a loved one, when you lose your job, when you lose a significant other, the Lord is your strength. When you feel weak, you feel like you can't get through that, the Lord is your strength. Now when sin begins to tempt you, when things start to not go your way, the Lord is your shield. He blocks you from the attack of the enemy. Now in the next passage, it says, those who know him, trust him. The Lord has never forsaken you. The Lord will never forsake you. As humans, we're sinful. We make mistakes. But God doesn't. And God will never forsake you. And in this last verse, it says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You can do all things. Anything that God wills, anything that God wants for you, you can do. You can do those through Christ. So when I say that God should be your number one priority, these are just a few pieces from Scripture that tell you why God should be your number one priority, why he loves us, why he does what he does. But let me ask you, some of you guys might be sitting in your chair saying, oh, Pastor Owen, God is my number one priority. Oh, yes, he is my number one. I love him with all my might. Let me ask you, is he a priority over your phone? Is he a priority over your computer? Is he a priority over your job, over making money, over your family, over your significant others? Is he really your number one priority? Now, hear me out, church. I'm not saying those things are bad, all right? I'm not saying having a job is bad. I'm not saying making money is bad. I'm not saying prioritizing your family is bad. But when you prioritize it over God is when it becomes bad, when that becomes your sole focus, when all you can think about is that, when you think about that more than God is when it becomes bad. It's not bad in itself. God loves for you to have a family. God loves for you to have a job, to provide for the people around you, to have wants. Like Pastor Rachel showed, it's good to have wants, but is God your number one priority? That's what we're going to dive into today. So something I've been trying to teach in our high school ministry and in our youth group is now before our services, we have this thing called pre-service prayer, where leaders can come before service to pray. So that way when we're in service, we can love on the students, we can teach the students, we can disciple the students. But before all that happens, we focus on God. We say, God, you're at the center, you're at the start, and you're at the finish. At the end of our service, we have altar time where our students can take what God has put on their plate and they can really grab onto that. They can see, God, what are you doing? So we make time before and after service because God is the start and the end. God should be our number one priority. Now, do any of you remember what the second most important commandment was? Love your neighbor, love others. Sorry, I might do that for a time or two. Be ready. I'm going to keep you on your toes. But yes, love others. So your second priority going into 2024 should be love others. Prioritize others. Now, as I said earlier, we had Thanksgiving and Christmas. Now we got New Year's coming up. Some of you got some plans. Some of you might be going to plans where you're with people that you aren't really fond of. But you know what? Second most important commandment, love others. This amazing phrase that I was taught when I was younger was kill others with kindness. People may be mean to you. They may be rude to you. They may call you names. They may start rumors about you. But Jesus' second most important commandment is to love others. So even though these people are doing wrong by you, they're doing you dirty, they may hold a grudge against you, love others. So that means students in the room, when your parents may discipline you, when they may send you to your room, take away your technology, yes, you still gotta love your parents, and they're not doing it because they hate you, but they love you. Parents, when your kids act out, trust me, my parents will be in the next service. They're going to be like, amen. When your kids act out, love them. I promise you they're not doing this because they hate you. They're kids. They're going to mess up. We all make mistakes. But love others. On Wednesday nights, when I remember, sometimes I get all into the spirit, into scripture, but at the end of some of our Wednesday nights, we like to come and meet in the middle and put our hands in the middle. And I'll ask a student, what are we breaking down on? And we'll break down. We've done that a couple times because something I want to try and teach our students is that we're a family. We are all a part of the kingdom. We are all children of God. But if we're all divided, we're all not united, we're not going to succeed. We are a family. We're never going to succeed if we're too busy bickering with each other and fighting with each other. The only way we succeed is when we come together and we love each other. Second most important commandment, people. Second most important commandment. In John chapter 15, verses 12, it says, my command is this, love each other as I have loved you. This is a direct commandment from Jesus to love one another. He says, my command is this. He's not saying, if you want, if you can find the time, if you're feeling in a good mood, they buy you chocolate. He says, my command is this, love each other as I have loved you. This needs to be a priority, people. Trust me, I know, people do us wrong. They do us wrong a lot. And it's so hard to find that forgiveness, to be like, you know what? I love you anyway. With me being a high school pastor, I talk to a lot of high schoolers, and high schoolers are mean. Middle schoolers are mean, and it's so hard when they come to me with these struggles, with this hurt, and you gotta love them, man. It's hard, but you know what? This is a direct commandment from Jesus. Love each other as I have loved you. A direct commandment. Now, this leads me into our third most important priority of 2024. Prioritize love. Prioritize love. In 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 8, it says, above all, love each other deeply. Does it say love each other in a shallow way? Does it say love each other on a surface level? No, love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. Now, some of us like to read right over this verse and be like, oh, well, okay, sweet. Let's love. It covers a multitude of sins. But what does that really mean? What does it really mean to cover a multitude of sins? So when you love one another deeply, I love this, how he adds deeply, you're able to forgive. You're able to let go of greed. You're able to let go of envy, of shame, of all these different sins of the body. You're able to let go of those because you are loving. Not just loving, you're loving deeply. Loving each other deeply. Love is one of the greatest gifts from God. Something amazing I love about Jesus is that one thing that I take away most from Jesus' life is that he loved. He loved others. He loved the people that society deemed unlovable. Now, some of you might know the story of the woman caught in adultery. Now, this woman, she was caught in the act of adultery. Not going to go into specifics, but the Pharisees and the people of the town were about to stone her. Because in this time, if you were caught in that sin, you were deemed unlovable, dishonorable, unhopeful, and it was okay to kill you. But for those of you that know the story, Jesus stepped in the way. Stepped in the way and started drawing in the dirt. And all the Pharisees, the people of the town are like, what is bro doing? What is he doing? And he stands up and he says, those who haven't sinned may throw the first stone. Now, some of you might be like, oh, Jesus stood in the way. He didn't let her die. But what Jesus was doing was he was showing this woman love. He was showing her that even though these people might not love you, even though these people think there's no hope for you, I love you. Now, for those of you who know the story of Zacchaeus, he was a tax collector, Jewish tax collector. Everybody hated this man. Literally everybody in the town hated this man. And then when Jesus came to town, everybody's saying, Zacchaeus, get out of here. Jesus doesn't want to see you. Go to the back. Go steal money again. But you know what? Jesus walks right up to him and he says, I'm coming to your house. I'm coming to your house. A guy who society deemed unlovable, Jesus said, I love you. Now the woman at the well, this woman was a Samaritan woman. The Jews, they hated her. And you know what? Jesus walks up to her and he says, you know what? I love you. I love you. These are just a couple examples in the Bible of how Jesus teaches us to love. Now, the reason I say these stories is because these are people that society had deemed unlovable. These are people that society had deemed not hopeful. You don't belong in our church. You don't look the right way. You don't belong here. You've sinned. Oh my gosh, you've sinned. You're not allowed in our church. Jesus taught us to love the sinners. I like to think of the church as a hospital. A lot of us like to think of a church as a place that needs to be closed off from sin, but a church is a hospital for sick people. So when sick people are wanting to come into our church, why are we not allowing them in? Why are we not saying, yes, come here, let's help you, let's heal you. I have a cure. I have the cure for your sickness. Come in here. Let me help you. This not only applies to our friends and to the people in our community, but this applies to our family. How many of us have been hurt by a family member? I know I have. Forgive. Love. Pastor Steve spoke a couple weeks ago about how unforgiveness is like a poison. How when you hold unforgiveness in your heart, it's like drinking poison and expecting the other person to get sick and die. No, when you hold that unforgiveness in your heart, you're poisoning yourself. But like we said earlier, love covers a multitude of sins. If you truly love that family member, you will be able to forgive them. I promise you that. Now, worship team, you can head back up. So last January, most of you probably don't know this, but last January, my grandma passed. She was my rock. She was a person that taught me how to pray. She was a person that taught me how to love. She was a person that made me a lot of who I am today. And yes, sometimes she talked to me. I felt a little too much. When I was in college, I think she'd call me once a week to ask me how she could pray for me, to ask me if I have any tests coming up, if I had any homework, if I was injured in any sort of way. And then the next week, she would call me checking in. Hey, Owen, this is Grandma Sue. Like, I know who it is. I have your contact saved. But every single phone call, hey, Owen, this is Grandma Sue. How did the exam last week go? And you know, as a college student, I thought this was imputing on my time. And so a lot of times I wouldn't pick up the phone. But you know what? Grandma Sue always left a 2-minute voicemail because she loved. Regardless of whether her grandsons picked up the phone, she would leave them a voicemail, just letting them know, you know what? I still love you. I still care about you. When we go to Grandma Sue's, you know, when we were growing up, we'd go spend a week there and we absolutely loved it. It was the greatest week of the summer. But the older we got, we felt like this was a nuisance, a waste of time. We'd be looking at our watches. All right, you know what? I got about 20 minutes before I can get in the car and go home. Now, I know a lot of grandparents in here, you have the same thing going on with your grandchildren. For students, you do the same thing to your grandparents. Now, when my grandma passed, I reflected on it. And I was like, I didn't make time with grandma a priority. And even though I didn't make her a priority, a huge priority in my life, she taught me what my priorities needed to be. She taught me that God needed to be first, family and friends needed to be second, and love needed to be third. She taught me these things regardless of whether I picked up the phone or not. And that's one of my biggest regrets, is that I didn't prioritize the time that I had with my grandma. But I am thankful for the time that I had. But now, because of technology, I now gotta go back and look at those voicemails. When I'm feeling down, when I'm feeling like things are getting really hard, I have all these voicemails from Grandma Sue. Hey Owen, it's Grandma Sue. Just wanted to let you know that I love you. How'd the exam go? Is there anything that I can be praying for? Call me back when you can. It was never, why didn't you pick up the phone, Owen? This is the fourth time I've called. You haven't picked up the phone. What's going on? It was, just wanted to let you know I love you. Because Grandma Sue loved like Jesus. Regardless of how her grandkids, regardless of what people said to her, regardless of how people treated her, she loved people. And that's something that she taught me. Prioritize God, prioritize family, and prioritize love. Now today we're gonna kind of have a little bit of time where you can create an altar space in your chairs, where you can take these priorities and just let them marinate. Have some time with God. Now as we go into this new year, for those of us who feel like God hasn't been my number one priority, I can admit that. I've been too focused on this. I've been too focused on that. God hasn't been my number one priority. So now can I have everybody close their eyes and bow their heads for a second? We're just going to take some time. Now you can either pray to God out loud. You can pray to God in your hearts. But just start talking to God. God, what's been my number one priority? Reveal this to me. Reveal this to my heart. What has been my number one priority? Now, with every head bowed, every eye closed, if you're saying, you know what, God? You haven't been my number one priority, but I want to make you it. I want this new year, this 2024 season, I want you to be my number one priority. I want everything that I do after to be a reflection of you. If you're here today and you're saying that God hasn't been your number one priority, but you want to make him hit, can you just raise your hand as a public declaration that God, I want you to be my number one priority. I want you to be the number one part in my heart that when I go through my day to day, I want you to be my number one priority. Hands up all over the room. If you feel that you're alone, oh, I don't want to raise my hand. People are going to see me. They're going to see that I want to make God my number one priority. I promise you, you're not the only one. Thank you, Jesus. You can put your hands down. So we're going into this song. You guys can open your eyes. We're going into this song called Reckless Love. Now, something I absolutely love about this song is the term reckless love. Now, some of us don't quite know what this means, but reckless love means without caution. The way God loves you, the way Jesus loves you, is reckless. He doesn't love you because he's like, oh, well, I might get hurt. He might hurt me. Trust me, God knows you're going to hurt him. God knows you're going to make mistakes, but you know what? His love is reckless. He knows you're going to make mistakes, but he's going to love you regardless. Now, when we say unconditional love, loving others unconditionally, God is the only one that can love you unconditionally. We're humans. We make mistakes. Every human has that line. Oh, if they cross this, I'm just going to push them out of my life. They're gone. But God's love is unconditional. It means without condition. You're going to mess up. You're going to stab God in the back. You're going to stab him in the heart. You're going to say, God, I know you've told me not to do this, but I'm going to do it. But you know what? God's love is unconditional. You could make a million mistakes, and you know what? because of Jesus, God is going to still love you. God has reckless love. His love is overwhelming. It's abundant, without measure, and never cautious. Without caution. Love them because Jesus loved you first. What are your priorities going to be in 2024? How are you going to prioritize your life? That's the question I'm going to leave you with today. Worship team, you killed it this morning. Let's close this with a banger.
There's no shadow you There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
Father God, thank you for fresh starts and new beginnings. Lord, we can't go back and change the past, but we can start anew today in you. And I just pray, God, that you would help us to prioritize you. Help us to prioritize loving others. Help us to just prioritize love. God, I pray that your Holy Spirit would just do something in our hearts. Show us our grandma story, the person that we are neglecting, God, that you want us to, as of today, starting now, show love to that person. God, thank you for fresh starts and new beginnings. Father God, help us to prioritize loving you, loving others, and just love in general. We love you, Lord. We ask this in your name. And everyone said, amen. 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 You may be seated. One of our core priorities as a church is loving God by sharing his love with the world. I don't know if you know this, but at least 10% of our income as a church goes back into world missions. And two of our missionaries are actually members of our church, and they're going to be going to Cambodia in a few weeks. And I'm going to just show this video, and then we're going to invite Pat and Penny to come forward, and we're going to pray over them. But again, one of our core priorities is not just seeing Jesus the talk of this town, but to help Jesus spread the love of Christ to our world. So check out this video.
Good morning. My name is Pat, and this is my wife, Penny. And we're here to just let you know that we're in the process of going back to Cambodia. We started a ministry in Cambodia called Retained Lives. It's a ministry to keep little girls from being sold as sex slaves. We're a proactive ministry rather than a reactive ministry. And what we do is we find impoverished families that have daughters, and we bring them on into our ministry and give them a position in the ministry. Penny's going to tell you about what they do in the ministry center.
At the center, we bring in fabric. So we basically are mules going into their country, and then they, in turn, make quilts, and we bring the quilts back to the States and sell the quilts, and that gives them income to get them through, you know, sustains them each month so that they're not impoverished.
Mm-hmm. We want to thank this church for the prayers and the support that you've been giving us. Since last Christmas to this Christmas, we're happy to announce that we have planted 3 brand new churches in Cambodia with about 100 people attending the church service, with the 4th one just starting right now. And we'll be able to go there here in about 2 weeks and experience that 4th church as they are coming together.
So we just ask that you keep us in your prayers. It seems like every time we go over there, there's a hiccup, so to speak. Satan does not want us there. but we're just seeing God just move in such mighty ways when we are there. So it's like, it keeps you going. It just keeps you going.
We have Lauder Daughters there in Cambodia right now, and one of the main emphases that we have is to keep them in school. Education will go ahead and break the poverty cycle within that family. And our goal is to have every one of our daughters attain a university education. And we're really happy to announce that we have two of our daughters right now attending university. And what that's going to do is when they graduate with a university education, that will break the poverty cycle within that family. That daughter will take care of an elderly mother. That daughter, by God's grace, will be a Christian. She'll have a good education, and she will not be living in poverty. In fact, we're impacting a generation that hasn't even been conceived yet, because our daughters will not be living in poverty, and they'll not be forced to sell their daughters into sex slavery.
And isn't that exciting? Pat and Penny, come on down. Would you just stand with me, and we're going to just pray over this family, and if you would like to come forward and lay your hands upon them or just pray for that. You can stay where you're at, just extend your hand forward, but it is so exciting what God is doing through Pat and Penny, and we're going to just take some time now and pray over them. Father God, thank you for not just loving Kasson, but loving Cambodia. Thank you for loving the world, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Lord, I thank you for Pat and Penny and just what a blessing they are to our ministry and also to their ministries around the world. And Lord, I just pray for them as a family. God, I pray for an anointing upon their ministry. Lord, I pray for protection from accident, injury, sin, sickness, and all temptation. And God, I just pray that you would go before them and show them the way. And Lord, I just pray that your Holy Spirit would open up people's hearts to your gospel. God, we just love them, we appreciate them, and we just thank you that we can partner with them. We ask this in your name. And everyone said, amen, amen. Amen. Bless you guys. So we're going to now go into the offering time, and if you would like to give, there's a few ways that you can give. You can give through our church app. You can text give. If you've never done that before, you just text the word give to 507-204-7475. There's our website. You can fill out the information if you want to give there. Those of you who are watching online, we appreciate it. I heard from a lady who regularly attends our church from Nebraska. So if you're watching today, thanks for joining us from Nebraska. So 27337 County Highway 34, Kasson, Minnesota, 55944. That's where you can send your offerings if you would like. Those of you in person, as you leave, there's a box and you can drop your offerings there. And when you give, remember that you're not just impacting this community, but through all the missionaries we support worldwide. Now, in front of you is a little card. Would you please take that card out? Today, Pastor Owen talked about priorities. He talked about love. And I'll never forget this statement. Love is spelled T-I-M-E. Love is spelled T-I-M-E. So if you want to grow in love for God, you need to spend time, right? And one of the ways you can do that is by joining one of our process groups, and we have some of those coming up. So show me your card. Everyone, show me your card. Everyone got their card? Yes. So first of all, we have our casual to committed groups. You'll see Sundays, there's a Zoom class on Tuesday. Tuesday's women's, Wednesday night. There's a study called Divorce Care. If you've been through a divorce, we're very sorry. I'm so sorry. Maybe you know someone you can invite them to. This is a church that is not for divorce, but we're for divorced people. We have Grief Share. We have two of those classes, one on Tuesday night, one on Wednesday. Maybe you've lost someone recently, and maybe you haven't properly grieved that loss. This class will help you. We have Healing Hearts, one of the movements in our church. One of the best things going on in our ministry is this amazing movement of Healing Hearts. It's an amazing discipleship program, and it's about helping others heal. We have this amazing men's group on Saturday morning. Someone just told me this morning how wonderful that group is, guys just getting together. Young adults on Tuesday nights. Love and Respect is coming. So if you would, and then this Friday night, there is a chili cook-off, and just so you guys know, I'm really good at Yahtzee. So you can come and challenge me if you want, but I wouldn't recommend it because I am super good. Just kidding, but I am going to be there. Yes, I love Yahtzee. So if you would want to just fill this out and put it in the offering or just the welcome desk. But again, love is spelled what? T-I-M-E. So may God help you to prioritize Him this year. What are the priorities? Loving God, loving others, and love in general. So thank you so much for worshiping with us. We'll have friends up here to pray with you if you would like someone to pray with you. Also, I just want to let you know, if you have a teenager, a high schooler, you got to experience Pastor Owen's ministry. God is doing amazing things in our high school ministry, 9th through 12th grade. He's doing all the ministries, but since he spoke today, you got to experience his ministry. I would encourage you to invite those high schoolers to come on Wednesday nights to that amazing youth group. And again, thank you so much for worshiping with us today. Now may you go in the grace and the truth of our Lord Jesus Christ. And everybody said, amen. See you next year.